Hi, welcome to Frisky Talk 17. It's a pleasure to be back and to share this lovely conversation with the talented Baunder. All-around artist and all-around awesome person. It was wonderful to catch up with him during Miami Music Week to learn more about his story. From his first time buying a synth to the start of Soundexile to programming the electronic music for Hernan's symphonic show Connected, Baunder shares what he's learned from his decades of experience with the music while providing wise words that all aspiring artists can learn from. Thank you, Baunder, for making this happen and for sharing your thoughts with us for Frisky Talk 17.
Let me start then. Start.
Sure.
I know you've been doing this for a really long time, since the 90s, like late 90s?
Was that? Yes.
Yeah. So can you tell me about how it all started for you, like you first time going out?
Well, it all started when I was at school. I started DJing at school parties for friends. And then I remember it was late in the 80s, I got a cassette from my older brother that had some electronic music songs. I didn't listen to electronic music till then. And I was blown away, and I had a teacher that he knew electronics, and he said, all of this is made with a computer. I said, well, I need to know how this is done. And it all started that way. I bought my first synthesizer, and I started getting used to gear and technology, and it all came in from there. And I continued DJing and buying vinyl, and but I then at that time I was playing rock, and then started buying electronic.
So you're
vinyl,
DJing house music, like, and rock music.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. When I was young, when I was like 7 or 8.
Really?
Yeah.
On turntables?
Like, no, on cassettes.
Yeah, oh my
it was weird.
Awesome.
But then I started buying vinyls. By the time I was 12 or 13.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah. So you just got like a sense of like that music just hit you in the right way, and you wanted to know.
It was just listen to the first time to this cassette, and it was like, okay, I need to do this. I need to know how this is done. And
yeah.
I started investigating. Imagine that there was no internet.
Right.
In Argentina, magazines were very late. They arrived late, so technology was old by the time it got to Buenos Aires. So it had to be done very raw, but... Eventually we got there.
I feel like that kind of gives you more passion, or like you get the reward from it.
Yeah, for sure.
You have to work.
Exactly. Yeah.
So how did you end up finding, like, did you have mentors or?
No, I mean, there was a magazine that's called Future Music that we got it there, like I say, like 5 or 6 months late, or even more. But there was one shop in Buenos Aires that sold synthesizers that the guy knew his stuff. So we started talking a lot. So I bought all the stuff from him, and he showed me different things. And the thing is, when you're young and you earn little money, you just buy one synth and you learn it inside out before you buy the second one. In that way, you really needed to learn your instrument.
Yeah,
and I think that's good, because now I understand synthesizers and samplers in a better way, I think.
Do you still have
your original? I mean, I sold all the original ones.
Yeah.
I went to live to Spain. I came back and I bought. I have a rather nice studio now, and it's all hardware since.
Oh,
because I don't really like computers. I prefer.
Well, you did a good job.
Yeah.
that's the reason why, right? It could have been a lot easier.
Yeah. But I prefer having knobs.
The touch and
yeah.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah.
So you started out kind of just doing on like you were DJing as a kid, but producing, and then did you go out to like see DJs play? Or
I mean, I played with vinyl for a while, mm-hmm. and then then the logical step was CDJs. Burning CDs and getting CDs to burn bad, and you had to burn it again. Yeah, I really, really like technology right now. Much, much more easier.
It is, but it's still in the same point where it's like, because things are easier, people don't have to work as hard, and if you don't work as
hard,
exactly. It's not
like. But if you've been doing this for a while, it's nice That's to true. Have something easier right now.
So did you kind of know that was like what you wanted to do for a career, or did you have other?
I had it in mind. It wasn't that easy to explain to the parents.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I studied nothing that wasn't related to that, but I always had this passion for music, and I kept staying in my bedroom making music. Started making, recording vinyl into the computer and then chopping beats and making another song out of it.
Oh, that's so cool.
To make my own versions of songs.
Your own remix.
Then when I was, I think this was 24 or 25, I decided to go to live to Spain in order to do a career in music.
Wow.
So I just...
Did you know anybody out there?
Nobody. What, I sold all of my stuff. I got a plane ticket and I went to Spain with my brothers and just see what happens.
That's so cool. So
at first I had to do different works that were not music related, but then I started working at a record label.
Oh.
And
what label was?
Label is called Beat Freak Recordings.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Owned by a Spanish guy. I worked there for like 2 years. And then through the music I made there, I met Oliverio and we started Soundexile.
Oh, okay. So he was in Spain?
He was living in Spain. I was living in Madrid. He was living in Barcelona.
How did you guys meet?
I was making music that was getting released. He once heard a song. He said, I have a song that I can't finish. He had a label that was called Offside Recordings. And he said, would you remix a song for me? I did it. He liked it. And he said, I have a song that I can't finish. Would you like to do it? If we do it both. I said, yes. After that, we started doing music together.
Oh, that's so cool.
12 years now.
Yeah, that's awesome. I was wondering kind of, you know, the teamwork aspect of it, how that came about. And, you know, you guys found that working together, like you just balance each other or?
Yeah, because we actually come from different musical backgrounds. His mother is a piano player. He's a piano player. I learned music at a later stage. But we both have different music influences. So I think that the mixture of both is what makes what we do.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. That's cool. You guys play, like you started DJing together as well? Or
We came back to live in Buenos Aires.
Oh, really?
In 2006.
Okay.
And then that's where we started playing together.
Okay. That's where I see
first we were just doing things via Skype.
Oh, really? Yeah. So even in Spain, you guys didn't ever see each other?
Exactly.
Oh, how funny.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And then we got together in Buenos Aires, and then from then on, we started playing and producing together.
Yeah, so was that kind of like when you knew this was your...
So basically, I had to go away from my country for 5 years to really realize that that's exactly what I wanted to do, and then come back and do it.
Were you like the start of progressive, like in 2006? Like, were you part of like that scene just started kind of?
Yeah, but the thing is, progressive it was very big in Buenos Aires very early on. I mean, from like 99, 2000, when trance became progressive and stuff.
Right.
Hernan was already a big star there, and the music was big there. Then I think there was from 2002 till 2006. It was like some music was...
It's like a weird...
Yeah, exactly. Weird is the word. And then from 2006, it began. It came back, and I think it never stopped.
do you guys, you said you both have, you know, the different backgrounds, but what about your similarities?
I mean, we both like house music. We all, the basic house music, you know, the groove, the big bass. I mean, that's, I think, what gets us together. Just then we can go one song, we can go more progressive and the other one go deeper. That's just depends on our, how we feel that day. I mean, we're not like tied to, we have to do this kind of music. We like a lot of music and we just start something and say, okay, this could go this way, this could go this other way. It's no problem. But I think mainly it's the house groove and melodies.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah, just the essence.
Exactly.
Awesome. What are your goals with Soundexile versus yourself now?
I mean, it's just, I don't see it as two different things.
No?
Okay. We both do other stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I have another project that is more like trip hop and other music, yeah, completely. But that's something I'm gonna do sometime along the way. Not right now.
I was curious, yeah, if you'd like experimented.
Yes,
with
I really like that. And I got into modular synthesis, and that it's taking me into more electronic based music, but more analog stuff. Not so many melodies, but some mixture of noise and ambience and yeah.
Cool.
So I'm going to do that, something with that, but at a later stage.
Yeah. Do you ever feel like you just got bored with doing the same like style?
I don't get bored, but I really like to mixing things up. So I prefer, like, when we're doing music with Hernan for his balance CDs, you know, that's the first CD is down tempo and the second CD is more club. I really like doing the first CD. Much more,
yeah.
The music
dance,
for the first
CD,
yeah, because it's moodier and
yeah. So when you're in the studio, do you normally have like a plan of somebody wants you to write a track or you want to write a track or you know like a remix? How do you kind of plan out your?
I mean,
studio
time? Have schedules when you need to remix stuff, but when I'm doing music on my own or with Audi Radio or with Hernan or whatever, I try to get into the studio with a blank sheet and just nothing in my head. Just see what happens. I mean, sometimes I would start a track and then Oli Radio would add things and then sometimes he starts a track and I add things. I mean, it's both ways.
But you guys live near each other now?
No.
So no.
No, we still do everything instead of Skype via Dropbox. But yeah. Yeah, we get together, but we don't get together every day.
Yeah. No. What's your normal like schedule? Like,
we don't. That's the thing.
Yourself,
we're very laid back. We don't have a schedule. We do. We get together maybe once a week or every 2 weeks. Yeah. Yeah, but the thing is, right now with high speed internet and stuff, just I uploaded this to Dropbox. Oh, I'm gonna. It's just easier now. You don't really need to be in the same place. And the thing is, when you're used to your studio, moving to another person's studio is not that easy.
Yeah.
I know my scenes, I know my stuff, I know my things. Oliverio knows his stuff, so
that makes sense.
Everyone has its own control and then we get together.
Yeah.
We mix everything out.
Well, I like what you had said earlier about, you know, things being easier now, but appreciating when things were harder.
Yes.
You know, that you had to learn it kind of the hard way. Do you think that's something missing for people, you know, that are starting out today or like,
yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I teach production classes in
Buenos
Aires.
Yeah.
I don't have a lot of pupils. I prefer to have less, but more intense. And the first thing I talk to them is like, they have a certain lack of, how would you say, When I was young, I remember I bought a vinyl. I would read the credits. I would read the record label. I would investigate everything, even not having internet. You had to do everything manually.
Yeah.
sometimes you talk to young guys and they don't know who produced this, who's the label. So I say, I try to teach them that it's really good to go back and see what happened and why it happened and how it got to where it's now.
Yeah.
Because like I said, I'm going to go meet one of my legend idols in today. And anyone I talk to about him, they don't know him.
Yeah.
And for me, it's like this big star. So it's just, and he's the real influence in my style of music. So
why is that? It's
basic house music.
Yeah.
But for me, it's great. When they say, when the kids say, where does your music come from? There. Listen to that. And then you will understand why my music is this way and not the other way. I try, but not.
Well, in your own way.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool. What else is kind of an important not technical aspect that you teach?
Not technical. I think the it's just a concept. That's patience. No one's rushing you. You don't need to release stuff right now. And take your time. Be good. Instead of just rushing things and doing tracks every 3 days, and because I normally get tracks from people sent, and I like, if you take more time, you can get this to be better. You can, and then you get more chances to reach your DJ or your label that you want.
Right.
I feel like the young generation are like, I need it fast right now.
Yeah.
So I try to teach them, slow down, sit, enjoy the ride, because no one's putting a gun in your face and saying you have to make music. You want to make music. So if you want to make music, just enjoy. Enjoy the process. Do a lot of things. I tell them, enjoy every part of that. When you're composing, enjoy composing. Don't think about, I need to EQ this. Wait, you're gonna do it later. Enjoy play the piano, play the keyboards, enjoy that part. Once that is done, start mixing. Enjoy the mixing. And once that is done, enjoy mastering. Because everyone, it's like, oh, okay, I got this melody, but the EQ is wrong. Wait, focus on the melody first. If the melody is great, then go and find the perfect sound. But first, find the perfect melody.
Yeah, and that falls into the patience, too. Yeah, exactly. Just not trying to rush onto the next. Well, have you had like a lot of... it must be really rewarding working with people and watching them like develop. You had, you know, people that you're really proud of how they've come through.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I have the luck of working with a lot of kids that are going to be big soon.
Yeah.
Yeah. At least for me, I think. Yeah. So that's actually really good. Hernan, for example, last night in the boat party played a remix of a guy
Oh, that's awesome.
We did it. We mixed it in my studio. So I was really proud. I sent him a video. He was really happy. So.
That's so cool.
Yeah. That's really rewarding.
Yeah.
When you first hear the first chords, it's just like, that filming.
Awesome.
Yeah,
what do you think's the hardest part, like, is there anybody who kind of just can't get past a certain part of creating you know, that you think they're not going to get to the next level because they don't have a certain like quality, or is everybody?
No, I mean, you realize that sometimes just, and I'm honest with them. I'm never going to say you're not going to make it, because that's not true. Nobody knows. But I sometimes prefer to say maybe you should try another teacher. Maybe I'm not the one for you.
No.
Just start.
That's good.
I mean, it doesn't mean that he's not going to make it, or just
Yeah.
I prefer when I feel like I'm stuck and I can't give anything more, I just go with someone else.
Yeah. That's good. How long have you been doing that?
3 years now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I'm not a technical teacher. I'm not I like people come with, I have a problem with this, and we solve problems. I like that.
Oh, okay.
So it's just one-on-one. It's not like a class with 10 people. It's just one-on-one always. And it's like, well, I have a problem with this kick drum. Let's sit and we'll find a way. I prefer that instead of saying, okay, a compressor works this way.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's a unique kind of, how'd you get started doing that?
I don't know.
Just for you, I don't know.
I mean, I've never had any proper music production.
Right.
I just learned it from when I was young and bought synths and started recording. So what I do is that, and that's why I always say it's not the law. It's how I do it.
Yeah.
If you come to me because you like my sound, then this is how I do it. I mean, it's not like this is how it has to be done.
Yeah, and that's an important thing too. I've heard some, you know, people say not to do like the online tutorials and just to like forget that, mm-hmm. because if you start doing that, you're just gonna kind of be copying what other people are doing.
I mean, if you can watch the tutorial and get things from that, but not everything, but some useful thing, I think it's okay.
Yeah,
I encourage them to watch tutorials, but I say, what the guy is saying is not the law.
Yeah.
I mean, it's his way of working. I mean, you might find, for example, you can get to the same results. Maybe my way is slower and his way is faster, but we get to the same results. So then it's your choice to decide which one you take.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. What a nice way to teach. That's wonderful. What else are you, like, what's your normal, you know, daily life like?
I wake up very early in the morning because I really like to sleep.
Yeah.
So I prefer, I need to take this as a job, you know? I wake up, I put on my alarm clocks, 6:30 in the morning. I wake up, coffee, shower, studio.
Studio, yeah.
And then it's just the whole day in the studio.
Then wow.
If I have to do things, I go out. The thing is, when you get to work, mainly music, you can go out and come back. It's not like a real schedule that you need to punch hour in and punch out. You just do it.
Yeah.
But I like to wake up always very early, and because I'm much more creative and productive, in the morning.
Yeah. You know, I've heard that as advice from people that, like, if there's something you have to get done, just get up and do it. Otherwise,
because your ears are clear, your brain is rested. You're like, I think it's more like what I said before, the start with a blank page. It's like you wake up and everything is fresh. Then during the day, you go out, you hear siren, and then things get mumbled in your head. So just, I prefer mornings much more. Yeah.
Nice. Well, that's a nice life. That's great. What are you like most proud of in your career?
Well, last year we did with Hernan Cattaneo, we did a show that's called Connected. That is a symphonic show of electronic music. We did 4 shows in Argentina's biggest theater. It's one of the world's biggest theaters. And
how many people is it?
It's 2,500 people, but the theater is most known for its acoustics. It's just like, I think it's the fourth or the fifth best acoustic theater in the world. I mean, the place itself has no PA, So yeah. A singer stands in the middle of the sings, and you can hear it in the last
and like
row.
Everyone has to hear it.
Yeah,
the
exactly.
Same.
So it was a big challenge because the place is actually not made for PA. So our electronic part had to be lower in volume, so the acoustic instruments would shine. Yeah, but it
right.
was an amazing experience. It's something I've never done before, working with a 50 instruments.
So what was your musicians. Main role?
We were in charge of all the electronic music.
Yeah.
From the composing stage to the playing in the theater. Yeah. And then we did a live show, an outdoor show for 40,000 people in the middle of the woods in Buenos Aires.
40,000 people?
Yeah, 40,000.
Oh my god.
Amazing.
So you had a huge
yeah.
PA
yeah.
for that.
Yeah, that one we had to remix everything we did for that show because our part had to be louder
yeah.
and more important. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was great. That's something I'm most proud of.
Yeah, you yeah. want to do more of those?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Much
so
more.
That's awesome. Pulling that kind of gives like a respect. I think the electronic music is getting some more respect.
Exactly. I think that shows that electronic music can be appreciated by a much larger audience. It's
yeah.
just the clever. I mean, we did a show that everyone was sitting mm-hmm. and they were just listening to a concert with electronic music. So I think that proved people that, we're not here just for the party.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that might be a lot of really the pioneers of electronic music as we know it are older. You know?
Yeah.
So it's like, no, everybody's still doing it.
Exactly.
And it's... you know, people still want, they want to hear that. I mean, I think it's amazing that how far it's come.
Yes. In so little years, actually, because it's 30 years.
Yeah.
It's not that much.
Yeah.
I think
there's probably a lot of people that thought it was like a phase.
Yeah.
Or
like a fashion or something.
Yeah.
And it just turned out into something much more. To learn
yeah.
is the passion that,
yeah.
because like we said before it wasn't you right now you have Ableton Live, a computer, and you can already make music. In the older days you had to buy equipment. It was an expensive thing to do because you had to have a studio. Right now you can do it in the airplane with a computer and your headphones, then
yeah.
you can polish it, but I mean the main idea, you can do it. Before it wasn't done that way, so I think the passion, it was made before, I think, because it was something harder to do. I think the passion
was harder,
bigger.
Yeah,
I think
really
now it's something like
it.
Ah, yeah, I can do it right now. Like I can send an email and I can make music, so, like all on the same level, I think.
Yeah, that's so true.
Yeah,
and not just focus
exactly
on it and the dedication. I'm sure it's all kind of natural to you now. You've done it for so long, but what about the hardest part of producing? Like, is there anything that's still difficult for you?
I mean, it's always, I think the hardest part is sitting in front of a white blank page and
yeah.
getting to do something. There's days that you might have nothing and stay for 2-3 days and get no ideas, and then sometimes you get five. I mean, it's so random.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think when you've been 3 days and you didn't get any idea, you start to worry. You start to worry like, oh, something's wrong. But then you wake up the next day and you get, oh, I have this idea. And then a track turns out of that. So, I mean, it's hard, but it's not that hard.
No, but that's difficult. I mean, I think it's hard for any creative person to have to, you kind of fight against your own mind.
I mean, and when you talk to people, they're like, ah, well, but you just sit and make music. It's not that easy.
You know?
People think that you just play a couple of keys, computer, and then
I won't tell
the
them
song's
you do
done.
It. Yeah, you try
and
that.
It's not that easy. Yeah.
What about like the industry side? You know, has that having to deal with, you know, kind of the business end of your career? Has that ever?
I haven't had that bad experiences,
yeah,
at least right now, for now. But I know that there's people that is in it just for the money. There's people that's in it for the passion. So I guess the people that are in it for the money may not be so interested in what you do, but how many people you bring in. So
yeah, I mean, with number, you know,
exactly,
people looking
numbers
at, like, your social
exactly. Exactly. In Argentina, it got to a moment, I mean, 3 or 4 years ago. Now it got a little bit better. But the thing was, okay, but how many people do you bring? That's your job.
Not mine, right?
Well.
Yeah. And then I know, you know, there's a lot like looking at social media.
Exactly. Well, that's the hardest part for me is social media. I can't find the time to do that while I'm doing music. I prefer doing music, and then I get late on my social media. You know, like if I have to upload a flyer or something, I never do it on time. I do it later because I'm doing something else. I mean, it's a little bit harder to balance that, but that's still not a problem.
Yeah. 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 Mm. Just kind of become a part of, you know, like
what you have to do.
Yeah. When it didn't used to be. I know you said you were looking at moving to other places, would want to live other, like, what are some other scenes that you feel like are up and coming or maybe underappreciated?
I mean, I like, I've been to Berlin 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like this, this new generation of this mixture of melodic techno and house that gets mm-hmm. in between to the progressive side of things. And I've been to a couple of parties there, and it was great. It wasn't just mainly techno. You can get other parties that are just more melodic.
Mm.
And I think that's getting bigger there. So that's something
that would
be nice
to have,
to
like
be
a little more melodic side of it.
I mean, they're still gonna have the big techno scene because that's Germany, but I mean this new, it's not that new, but I've been to a party that was an outdoor party at 3 p.m. in the afternoon on a great day by a river. It was a Poker Flat Recordings party, and you have Alex Nigeman and Steve Bug, and it was a really great party, and I heard music that I didn't expect I was going to hear. It was like, it wasn't progressive, but it was on the way.
So it was progressing towards progressive.
Exactly. So it was a great mixture. I think it was very melodic. It was more techno maybe, but not hard techno. I don't like hard techno. So it was like perfect music for me.
Nice.
And I think if that continues to grow, I think it's going to be really big.
Oh, do you see like Argentina staying, you know, is that moving towards, I kind of heard people trying to get more of a deep kind of.
Yeah. I mean, it's getting bigger. Argentina used to be mainly progressive. Now it's not so centered around progressive, but, and you have a lot of deeper parties.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go to Buenos Aires, you have a big DJ every week.
Yeah.
Maybe Friday and Saturday. So it's just one day it's John Digweed, the other day it's Sasha. It's amazing. If you're a fan of electronic music, Buenos Aires is one of the places to be, for sure.
Do you go out?
I go out. I don't go out that much. But I do. Every time I see someone I want to see, I go out.
Yeah. Who's someone, a DJ you think is really, you know, at top of your list?
Well, John Digweed, I think, is very big. But I've seen Sasha. I mean, all the big ones. I'm a big fan of the big ones. Also, Guy J. When Guy Gerber comes to town, he's a really great DJ. So, there's a lot. I mean, I don't go out maybe every weekend, but when I get a chance, I do.
Nice.
Yeah.
So what about producers? Like, someone you think is either, you know, someone you've been hearing that is up and coming that you think's doing a good.
Okay. I mean, there's a lot of great new talent in Argentina.
Yeah.
Like the guys from Interaxis.
Mm-hmm.
Nicolás Rada.
Mm-hmm.
Marcelo Basami, Mariano Mellino. There's a lot of great talent in Buenos Aires. Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, it's really good. And that got big in like 3 years ago. It's not like come from way back. But in the last 3 years, there's a lot of great new talent. I like a lot Guy Gerber,
mm-hmm.
musically. Maybe not all of his songs are great, but musically they are brilliant. Mm-hmm. For me, Dixon, Adam Port, and me, I like those guys a lot. Yeah.
Nice. Okay. Yeah. Kind of gets that edge. Very kind of
a mixture.
Edgy. Yeah.
Exactly.
What gets you excited? What are you most excited about these days?
My life right now is doing what I want, so I think that's what gets me more excited. I mean, waking up in the morning and making music and not having to go to to put on a tie. I think that's what
awesome.
Gets me excited every day. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, what anything, you know, goals or anything that you would aspire differently than you're doing now?
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to. Travel more.
Yeah.
I'd like to play more abroad. I mean, we do a lot of shows in Argentina. We do a lot of shows in maybe Chile and the countries next to Argentina. But I would like to do more of a tour. We played in Japan. We played in Europe a couple of times, but I've never been to Australia. I would like to play in Australia. I would like to play more in America. So, yeah. I think one of the goals right now for the next years would be to play more.
Nice.
Yeah.
I mean, that's exciting, I think, to have that opportunity. And I think you will be able to do that. I'm sure.
Hopefully.
I'm sure you will.
Hopefully.
Awesome. Is there anything else you want to share or something maybe about, you know, what's most important to you with music or anything anyone should know?
I mean, I think... what I said before, patience, authenticity.
Oh, I know.
Sorry, very hard word.
It is a really hard word.
I mean, but those two things I think for me are the most important, because that's the way I take my music.
Yeah.
I don't rush anything. I'm not. I used to be very fast at producing.
Yeah,
when
I was
young.
Wondering if anything
very
changed
fast. Yeah.
From like when you were young to now.
And now I take
learned.
My time, because I'd like to appreciate every sound, and I try to make every sound shine on the production. Mm. I don't like to rush things. So I think that's like my main thing, patience.
Yeah.
And I'm a very patient guy, so I have no problems with that.
Oh, that's wonderful. I think that's such do you know Forerunners?
Yes. Could,
yeah, that was what his answer to me was, patience as well. And he's saying, you know, people, you have this pressure, like, oh, I want to put out a track. I got to put out a track, or I'm not. And
but the thing is, you don't have to. You
yeah,
want
I love
to.
That. You don't.
But if you want to, you why rush?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I think that's, and especially in today's world, it's such great advice.
I don't know if it's the best. I don't know if the industry always tries to for you to be faster, but you can go against the industry sometimes.
Yeah.
And do your own way and get there a little bit late, but get there.
Yeah, get there more like you said when you get tracks.
Exactly.
Like they're not. Yeah, you just finish that. Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you so much. This was really wonderful.
Thank you.